أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم آمين أما بعد tonight, inshallah, we discuss hadith number 11 in al-Arba'een al-Nawawiyyah. And this hadith is narrated in al-Nasa'i and al-Tirmidhi. It's a hadith Hasan, Sahih. This hadith is narrated by al-Hasan, Abi Muhammad, al-Hasan ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib, Sibti Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa rihanatu, radiyallahu anhuma wa ardahuma, قال سمعت أو حفظت عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دع ما يريبك إلى ما لا يريبك دع ما يريبك إلى ما لا يريبك. الحسن, as we know, is the grandson of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he tells us in this hadith that he memorized from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم directly. This very short hadith, دع ما يريبك, leave that which you have doubts about, which you have no certainty of knowledge about or about its authenticity, to that which you have no doubt whatsoever. So this hadith applies to our aqidah, our creed, it applies to our statements, it applies to our deeds, and it applies to every interaction that we have in terms of relationships that we build, individuals that we interact with, transactions that we conduct. Here the Prophet ﷺ first and foremost tells us about the character of the believer. And the character of the believer is mentioned or stressed in the Quran in many places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَكَانُوا يَتَّقُونَ. Those who are in the trust and the custody and the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have nothing to fear. So the hadith addresses people like that, those who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who are in a state of ikhbat. Ikhbat means that they're in a state of obedience and submission and love and willfully coming to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance and in asking for forgiveness, and they're in a state of serenity and comfort, knowing that they're in a state of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all times, or at least most of the time. So these people have taken the fitrah and have shaped it with the Quran and the Sunnah, and have resorted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that everything they do, the success of which is dependent on being close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they become the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, under the custody and the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses people like that in many places in the Quran, particularly Surah Al-Hadid, where he says, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَآمِنُوا بِرَسُولِهِ يُؤْتِكُمْ كِفْلَيْنِ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ نُورًا تَمْشُونَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. I mention these ayat because they give us an idea about the insight of the believer versus the ordinary person. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ or you who believe have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, means that submit to Him in all orders that He has given you in the Quran and the Sunnah, and stay away from all prohibitions that He commanded you to stay away from in the Quran and the Sunnah, and submit and obey His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Use Him as your leader, as your role model. يُؤْتِكُمْ كِفْلَيْنِ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you twice the share of His mercy. وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ نُورًا, and this is the emphasis that we need to put on, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you that guiding light, that ability to see and distinguish between truth and falsehood, misguidance and guidance, ability to make, to successfully make the right choice. Add to that what the Prophet ﷺ has taught us in the hadith, which is dua al-istikhara, where we pray two rak'ahs, and these rak'ahs are not part of any nafila, that is part of our salah, or an obligatory salat that we pray five times a day. So this is separate two rak'ahs that the Prophet ﷺ has taught us, by saying, اللهم إني أستخيرك بعلمك وأستقدرك بقدرتك فإنك تعلم ولا أعلم تقدر ولا أقدر وأنت علام الغيوب. Oh Allah, I seek your guidance and I seek your help because you know and I don't, and you're able and I'm not, and I ask for your guidance every step of the way. So if I'm about to pursue a matter of worldly nature, or even a matter of religious nature, like seeking, marriage. You know, should I marry this woman versus that woman? Is this the right woman for me? Is this the right man for me? So these are acts that we are encouraged to highly, perform this istikhara, seeking the help and the insight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He knows and we don't. He knows what's best for us, even though sometimes we think we know what's best for us. As He says in the Quran, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And perhaps you would hate something, like going for jihad fi sabilillah, or doing qiyam al-layl, which is so hard on us, or doing other acts of worship, and thinking that this is, the nafs is not inclined towards things like that, because nafs is typically inclined toward things that are comfortable and easy to do and pleasurable. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, yes, your nafs dislike that, but in it there's a lot of good for you. And yet, yes, your nafs may like the other thing, but in it there's a lot of harm for you. Wallahu ya'lamu wa antum la ta'lamu. So this confirms that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who knows the secret and that which is more hidden, He knows what's best for us a lot more and a lot better than we know what's best for us. So in dua al-istikhara, the Prophet ﷺ teaches to always go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asking for His advice, for His guidance, every step of the way. And those who are most successful in achieving this dua successfully and making the right decisions are those who are constantly returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning that al-awwabeen, like those who pray salat al-duha, those who do qiyam al-layl, those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has opened a door of dua supplications for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not open a door for any of His slaves except that He will respond favorably to that slave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not enable a person to do qiyam al-layl on a regular basis and then deceive him or disappoint him. Wal-iyadu billah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He grants you the success to do that which is right, that which He likes, and of course that which He likes is obligatory. As mentioned in the hadith, there is never the case that a slave of mine can come close to me except with that which I have made obligatory upon him. Salah, siyam, zakah, hajj, all of that. وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلِ. Second in place is for us to continue to come closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the nawafil, means the additional acts of worship. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves us, and then the long hadith says then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command Jibreel, to love this person. And then Jibreel alayhi salam will call on to the people, the angels in the seven layers of heaven, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves so and so, love him, so they would love him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yada al-qabool lihada shakhs, means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give acceptance on earth of this person, things that he says and things that he does. And that goes for males and females as well. So going back to the hadith, I just wanted to lay this foundation that this hadith is not for everyone. This hadith is for the believers. This hadith is for those who have knowledge of the deen. This hadith is for those who have the right fitrah that they continue to nurture and shape and guide by way of the Quran and the Sunnah. So if someone, God forbid, is corrupt and will come and say, دَعْنَا يُرِيبُكَ إِلَى مَا لَا يُرِيبُ. Leave that which you have doubts about to that which you have no doubts about. This person doesn't know which way to go. This person doesn't know where he should have doubt and where he shouldn't have doubt. This person doesn't have the knowledge to distinguish between what's right and what's wrong. So this hadith addresses the believers. This hadith addresses the Muslims who are in constant submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when it comes to the knowledge, we learn from the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to seek refuge in Allah, protection in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, min ilmin la yanfa, from knowledge that does not benefit. So if we see a book or grab a book or read an article that has no beneficial knowledge in it, immediately doubt kicks in, because this knowledge is against the fitrah. This knowledge, we can see that there is no good deeds that are going to follow as a result of reading this book, reading this article, reading this piece of information, so therefore we set it aside. Similarly, when it comes to our deeds, we know that a fiqh rule teaches is that al-yaqeenu la yazulu bil-shak. I entered into my salah, I have my wudu, I am certain I perform my wudu. Now I have doubts whether anything emerged out of my private parts that will nullify my wudu. The doubt cannot take the place of that which is certain. So therefore I say A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem, and I set the doubt aside and I go back to the rule, to the default, which is I am certain I have my wudu, I continue with my salah. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ has taught us. He says, unless you found or you know sound or smell, then do not leave your salah. Stay in your salah because it's from Satan. So when it comes to our ibadat, the rule is that al-ibadat tawqifiyya. Tawqifiyya meaning that we have to have evidence that this is a valid ibadah that is mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah, that the Prophet ﷺ has taught us, that the scholars convey to us. If we have doubt about this ibadah, we have a million ibadah, an actual ibadat that we are certain about. So we leave the one that we have doubt about to the one that we have no doubt about. A second example is that when people sometimes raise their hands to make dua, and then after that they wipe their faces. There's really no evidence in the Quran or the Sunnah that the Prophet ﷺ engaged in such behavior, that he wiped, you know, his face after making every dua. He used to make the dua, ruqya, before going to bed, and reciting, you know, Surah Al-Fatiha, Surah Al-Ikhlas, Surah Al-Falaq, Surah Al-Nas, and then he would say, Allahumma arqini min kulli sharrin yu'dini wa min kulli ayni hasidin. Allahumma ashfini, O Allah, give me ruqya, protection, cure, heal. Min kulli shar, from every evil that may touch me, and from the evil eye, from every envious eye that may harm me. And then he would wipe on his entire body. So this is mentioned in the Sunnah. But raising our hands in dua on regular basis and then wiping our faces, there is no evidence in the Sunnah. So many people have doubt about that, so therefore you leave that aside. Because the default again, al-ibadat tawqifiyya, means that you stop before you pursue ibadah until you authenticate that this ibadah is part of our deen. That this ibadah is part of our deen. Similarly, sometimes we get dhan. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِّ إِنَّ بَعْضَ الظَّنِّ إِثْمٍ. All you who believe, set aside, avoid, protect yourself from doubts. Meaning that an idea comes to you, thinking about a person, that this person perhaps has deceived you, or lied to you, or spoke ill of you, or any of that, but you have no evidence. So therefore, you do not pursue that doubt by investigating. You do not take it to another step. You say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim, and you think of your Muslim brother and your Muslim sister well. Why? Because the default is that for those we interact with, we pray with, and we fast with, and we deal with, and we think well of them, and they have good reputation in the community, and good reputation, you know, throughout the ummah, we ought to think well of them. That's the default, unless we see with concrete evidence that they've committed something wrong. Vice versa, a person who's corrupt, we do not take their statements to be valid, to be authentic. We do not trust them unless they give up their corrupted ways and then they come back to Islam and they rectify, you know, the wrong they've done and they pursue a better and more morally appropriate way of life. So therefore, the default of thinking of our Muslim brothers and sisters is that they are good and their Islam is good and their Iman is good unless we see something, again, of solid evidence to show that there is a compromise in their deen, be it in their aqidah, or be it in their ibadah. So therefore, we ought to think well of them. So if Satan whispers something bad, or instills something bad, or throws something in our hearts, to make us doubt our brothers and sisters, to disbelieve them, to distrust them, one of that, we say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim, we do not take any steps to investigate. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا, and do not spy on one another. وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا, do not engage in any type of behavior where you hear words about a person that are inappropriate. And you sit there and listen. You become part of the that sin. You've committed an equal sin because now you have a role. You cannot be complacent. Now you have to defend your Muslim brother and sister just like if they're standing behind a wall listening to you and listening to what you're going to say in their defense. That's how we defend them. And that's how we'd like for them to defend us if something ill has been said about us. So they are the ones who are going to defend us. So we defend them the same exact way. Similarly, in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, إِنَّ أَكْذَبَ الْحَدِيثِ أَظَّنُ. The most disbelieved words are doubts that Satan whispers into us, that the nafs whisper into us. So we rid ourselves by following the default, following the rule of Islam. دَعْ مَا يُرِيبُكَ, there's doubt about this. There's no solid evidence. There's nothing authentic about this. So I let it go. And I think well of my Muslim brother and sister. And I will give you one simple example. In our community, the other day, one brother, after the salah, grabbed his jacket, and there was a big spot on it. And he began to rub it on the carpet. And they moved to another spot, rubbed it there. So people are observing, and you can't help but to think, sort of like, why are you wiping something on the carpet? This is a masjid, right? So I walked up to him, and I just, there was an outstanding issue we talked about, and then I said, what are you doing? Just inquisitively. He said, I actually spilled the misk from my pocket on my jacket, and I'm rubbing it on the carpet to spread the smell. So subhanAllah, you set the doubt aside and you inquire. Because the nafs will oftentimes hasten towards what? Accusations. I can't believe you're doing this. You're dirtying the carpet in the masjid. You're doing... No, it's clearly it's a spot, but it's musk. It smells good, and he wanted to spread the smell, you know, all over the masjid. So this is something, you know, we oftentimes when you have doubt, when you have fun, when you have ill thoughts, stop yourself. Stop yourself. دع ما يريبك إلى ما لا يريبك. Similarly, in you know, in so we mentioned the aqidah and the words. You know, if I'm about to utter words that have an accusative nature, or words that are unnecessary, or words that even just out of curiosity, and now we see, you know, words spread out through social media like wildfire, and people begin to say, I think I know what's going to happen. You know. And I think I know, you know, what this person is going to do. I know who's going to succeed in this area. I know who's going to fail. Aren't we like ijin on claiming that we know the ghaib? Even if it's an educated guess, you do not speak with certainty. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ لَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ الْغَيْبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. None knows the ghaib, the unknown. It's unknown to us. It's known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no such thing as ghaib to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's known. The reference point here is us. It's ghaib to us. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. There's no such a thing as past, present, and future. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's knowledge encompasses all. So therefore, when we start, you know, spreading these words and speculating and arguing about matters that may or may not take place, and even if they do take place, we don't know how they're going to take place. We don't know when, how, and where they're going to take place, but yet we continue to speculate. This is something we need to hold back. We need to hold back. Any words that may compromise our own reputation or the reputation of others, we hold back, we do not speak. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا خَيْرَ فِي كَثِيرٍ مِّن نَجْوَاهُمْ. And this is something for us, you know, to understand. That in much of the talks we engage in, there's not really much good in it. إِلَّا مَنْ أَمَرَ بِصَدَقَةٍ أَوْ مَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ إِصْلَاحٍ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. Except those who enjoin charity, صدقة في سبيل الله. معروف, that which is good, that which the Sharia collectively advocates and approves of, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards for. أو إصلاح بين الناس, or mending a relationship between two conflicting parties that happen to disagree or to dispute or to argue or to fight. So bringing these two together, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala approves of. And then he says at the end, وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَلِكَ ابْتِغَاءَ مَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ فَسَوْفَ نُؤْتِيهِ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. Anyone who engages in these acts with the intention that they want to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he or she will receive a tremendous reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the exception to all the talk, and I'll conclude with this one hadith. And this hadith is mentioned in Muwatta by Imam Malik. And this hadith is actually narrated by Isa alayhi salam. This hadith is narrated by Isa alayhi salam, where he says, you know, a lot of talk, roughly translated, a lot of talk, في غير ذكر الله, without the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, means speaking about the words of wisdom in the Quran or in the Sunnah, يقسي القلب. It makes the heart harden. وَإِنَّ الْقَلْبَ الْقَاسِ بَعِيدٌ عَنِ اللَّهِ. And the hard heart is far from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hard heart is far removed or far distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he adds by saying, do not look into the sins of people as if you are deities. وَلَا تَنْظُرُوا فِي ذُنُوبِ النَّاسِ كَأَنَّكُمْ أَرْبَابٌ. Don't look into the sins of people as if you are God. وَانْظُرُوا فِي, look into your own sins knowing that you are a slave. Knowing that you are a slave. وَإِنَّمَا النَّاسُ مُعَافَى وَمُبْتَلَى. People are of two different types. Those who are going through tribulations and being tested, be it in their health and their wealth and their family members, in any form or shape. وَمُعَافَى, and one who has been saved from these tribulations and these tests. فَرْحَمُوا أَهْلَ الْبَلَاءِ, have mercy on those who are going through tribulations. Have mercy on those who are going through tribulations. وَحْمَدُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى الْعَافِيَةِ, and say Alhamdulillah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spared me from this test. And this is a dua that the Prophet has taught us to say when we see somebody who's been tested, be it in their health or their wealth or their family or any of that, say Alhamdulillah الذي عافاني مما ابتلاك به. Alhamdulillah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prevented me the test that He has imposed upon you. So you can see the source of the information is one. The source of the words of wisdom is one. Be it Muhammad is saying this, Isa alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam, all of that, and that's why we hear these statements recorded by the prophets in the Quran, telling us that the messengerhood, these prophets and messengers are ikhwa limilla wahida, means that they are brothers in the milla, and then their mothers are different. So therefore, the source of the information is one, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by way of the wahi, by way of Jibreel alayhi salam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us that which benefit us, and to benefit us that with that He taught us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase us in knowledge. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who listen to the words of wisdom, no matter where they come from, and to grant us the ability and the success to follow them and apply them in our lives. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفروه سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خير السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته